Advice of W.C. Fields, never follow an animal act or children. Yeah, that's hopeless in my life. A few things in the life of the church we hope that you will take time to notice in the newsletter. We are actively involved in signing people up for the photo directory that's coming up. We'll be taking those pictures in October, the last weekend on Sunday. I think it's the 29th and 30th. Sign-ups are downstairs in the narthex. If you did not get a chance to sign up last week, make sure you have a chance to sign up this week. We already have some 30 people signed up, and we certainly are looking for more, and this is also an opportunity. I've talked to a couple people. If you have extended family that you'd like to have in those pictures, make sure you block some time for them. There are opportunities to have pictures taken that do not go into the directory, and so it's a service to provide, especially going into the holiday season, for those people who would like to have the opportunity of a formal picture. A couple other things going on. Most easy to see are some of these people from the Nehemiah small group. Stand up. And they're sporting t-shirts, new t-shirts for the church. We have t-shirts, polos, because John wouldn't wear a t-shirt to church. Wasn't so sure about a polo, but he did it anyway. We appreciate that. We even have small sizes for children and youth. Wow, you're working that runway. This year we have sweatshirts and long sleeve shirts as well. Everything is downstairs. We'd like you to have one order form per person. If you have multiple people in your family, pick up a couple of forms and then we can put those together. But one form per person, get everything put on there, and they'll be in a few weeks. Thank you. A little bit about the idea of the design. I went to a conference this past spring called Catalyst down in Cincinnati. It was kind of an evangelical conference, and it was interesting to hear their twist on some things, but to me it was about 5 years too late. It was all about race relations. And especially down in the Cincinnati area where I had just come from, we had already accomplished a lot of the big ideas that they were trying to espouse as brand new. But the theme stuck out to me, and it was uncommon. You've heard me spin it from the pulpit on a number of occasions, that when you look at the life of Jesus, it's uncommon. It calls us to be uncommon. Uncommon in how we love, uncommon in how we serve, uncommon in how we live. Oh my gosh, that could preach. Could also go on a t-shirt. And this one happens to be serve, because in the middle you have the foot washing and a verse that goes with it. Future designs might come in a different color and have a different squiggly mark to denote that idea of uncommon love and uncommon life. And that way, we have some variety in how we present ourselves out there in the world as well, that become fresh and interesting as we move. So we thank the Nehemiah Small Group for kind of spearheading this and moving it forward. Put in your orders and you can get them here in the near future. The last thing I want to point out is that while we often have visitors around here, we have a new face that's not going to stay new for very long. Well, I don't know that that came out right. Life in our world, April, it just is. April, Simon, come up. Our official first day of our new Christian Education Director is today. She comes to us all the way from the far-off corners of the world in Lima, Ohio, and happens to be connected in some way to this whole clan that sits up here in the front corner. She's already shared her talent with us musically in the past, and we look forward to hearing more of that voice in that sense. But she's going to spend the next couple of months getting organized and situated within our Christian Education Department, trying out all the different aspects and finding where she is most needed in fitting in firsthand, and then also giving leadership and mentorship to the whole of our Christian Education Department. We welcome you here. Finally, she's living all the way across the street. She'll be very difficult to find, and she'll be starting at the Rock this week. Next week.
Next week.
So starting to get involved. Stand up there. Say a little bit about yourself.
I'm short. Sorry. Good morning, everybody, and thank you so much for being here, part of God's Day. I'm so excited to be a part of this family and community church. I'm excited for the new things to come. Please know that my door will always be open, as well as my home. Just give me a couple of minutes to make sure that it's clean. I'm extremely excited for this opportunity. It must be pretty official because I'm even in the bulletin. So I'm excited to meet you. Don't be surprised if I'm not coming in to your services, to your meetings, to your groups, just to kind of see what's going on and then how I can possibly improve. If there's any concerns, you can bring those to me. But most of all, I'm just here to be a part of your life and to help grow with your journey and seeking out God. So thank you so much, and I think it's all ready.
All right. As I stated in my newsletter article, church moves forward. We always move forward. There may be transitions, comings and goings, but the church marches ever forward towards the kingdom of God. With that in mind, stand and greet each other in the name of Christ.
Please remain standing for the call to worship. Early morning, coffee. I need coffee. Late at night, still awake, take a pill to get some sleep.
Something to ease and relax.
flit, churn, worry, rush, impatiently wait. The chaos of a frenzied world presses in.
Oh, Lord, this is not as I had planned. Be still and know that the Lord is God. He is exalted among the nations. He is exalted throughout the earth.
Come, let us take time and worship the Lord our God.
You may be seated. Oh, coffee. We need coffee. The world churns and rushes at us. And sometimes we need many things to help us get us through a day. That also deserves an amen. But the thing that we need most is God. And God is always right there at our fingertips, waiting for us to seek God out. That's all we need. That is all we need. As we face this world that has storms and news that talks about the needs all over the place, we can face it because we have God, we have each other. We come this day to be a community of faith, a community to stand the gap with one another. To face the trials of each and every day together. To share in the victories, the wonderful thanksgivings that we have in our lives together. To hold one another in account to what God would have us do. It's important to be the church in this day and age. It's important to go out in the world and be the church. Something to think about as we turn our attention to our prayers. Pour out your Spirit upon us, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. Fill us. Fill us so that we overflow. You have blessed our lives with opportunity, things and people, places important. But most of all, you give us yourself. We thank you for the blessings that we have received. We thank you for the knowledge that you stand with us as we move forward into whatever trials we face. We thank you for this great community of believers and those who have gone before that have helped along the way to shape and mold our faith and to create this place. But this day, this day and tomorrow and the days to come, they're put to us to build your kingdom. Brick by brick, kindness by kindness, living an uncommon life that you have called us to live. Fill us with a full measure of your Spirit this day, that we might be worthy to the task. We lift up to you those names that we hold carefully on our heart, those people who are facing challenges in their lives this day, that equally need that full measure of healing, health, strength, courage to face whatever tomorrow will bring. We see so many things, so many needs. It is hard to find a way to deal with them all. And yet, that is not necessarily what you have called us to do. You've called us to deal with one at a time. To deal with each one in succession. Each one as it presents itself. Each one taking us closer to following in the example of Christ, who equally took each task as it came, each person as they came, one at a time, accepted, loved, sometimes corrected, but given the opportunity to be saved. In all these ways, we seek to follow in him, his footsteps, and to live out the words he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
And now the children can come forward for children's moment. You guys sounded awesome this morning. Thank you for sharing your singing. You know, today I'm going to be reading from the Bible, and a word that I use a couple of times at the beginning is the word authority. And that's kind of a big word. Does anybody know what authority means? Yeah, Aaron.
Like the government, like the law.
Yeah, like people in charge. Exactly right. People who maybe have power to make some decisions, to sort of maybe tell us what to do. You mentioned a couple of them right away, like the president or governors and things. Can anybody think of some other examples? Who might be somebody in authority? Yeah.
The mayor.
Yeah, the mayor. The mayor of Archbold, right? How about this guy? Who's this? Pastor Jim, okay, so he's got authority in our church, right? He can kind of make some decisions, and, you know, we kind of listen to some of his teachings, right? How about, who does this picture kind of represent? A teacher, right. She's got authority over your class. So, Blaney, if she says, Blaney, please sit down, you'd better sit down, right? She says, now we're going to take out our math book. We kind of need to listen. She has authority over the class. You mentioned one. How about this guy? A policeman. Yeah. He has the authority if I were, like, speeding down the road, which I wouldn't. I would never do that. His lights go flashing. I better pull over. Right? He has the authority to stop me and maybe write a ticket and tell me, ma'am, you need to slow down, okay? So, and then how about in your homes? Who has maybe some authority?
Our parents.
Yeah, our parents. This is me and my husband and Chan and Bryce. That was like 22 years ago. Now they're kind of grown. I don't have a lot of authority over them now that they're over 21. But back then, I did. Garrett and I kind of could have authority in our family to make some decisions, tell our kids, time to clean up your room, time to come in for dinner, to help them grow and be safe and be strong. Now, Jesus is going to tell a story to try to say who has authority and who's following the will of God. And that story went something kind of like this. What if I told, I've got two sons, what if I told both my kids, go clean up your room, okay? And one of them says, no, I'm not gonna do it. But later, he changed his mind, and he's like, oh, actually, I probably should. That's probably a good thing to do. And he goes and cleans his room. Now, the second son, he says, yes, I'm absolutely, Mama, I'm gonna do that. But he didn't do it. So who obeyed me? The first one, right, because he actually did it. So even though initially he said he wasn't going to, he came around. He had a change of heart and a change of mind. And that's what Jesus is going to say. You know, sometimes we don't always initially understand or do what God wants us to do, but if we have a change of heart and follow him, that's following the law. That's better than saying, oh, I love God, I believe in God, but then never do the will of God, right? So be thinking about that. When I read the story, and Pastor Jim is going to be talking more, our ultimate authority is God and Jesus. And we need to do what they're telling us to do, okay? Let's say a little prayer. Dear God, Thank you so much for your example of Jesus in how we should live. Help us always, always to remember to follow your will and your teaching. In your name we pray. Amen. The gospel reading this morning is Matthew 21, verses 23 to 32. When he entered the temple, the chief priests and elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" And they argued with one another, "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why did you not believe him?' But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' He answered them, 'I will not.' But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same, and he answered, 'I go, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father?" They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him, and even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him." This is the word of the Lord.
Long ago, in a state far, far away, I was a college student studying criminology. Yes, I was planning to be a cop. For a time, I was in various functions of law enforcement. I spent a year as campus security at the college. I worked as a security guard at Intel Corporation and at Harry and David's. For a time, I was a police reserve officer for the city of Phoenix, Oregon, where at the time, I was actually the next person to be hired full-time if and when a position came open. Oh, the stories I could tell. There's one night when I went to go see Jamie at her apartment after coming off of a shift as a security guard at the mall, I drove up and noticed a guy sprawled out in the front seat of the neighbor's Ford Bronco, an old-style Bronco that had no top. You remember those? Way back in the day? I'd never seen the guy before, so I went upstairs and asked Jamie, what does the neighbor look like? The description she gave me was nothing that looked like this guy, so I told her to go and call the police, and I went back downstairs and confronted the guy. Had him cuffed up before the police got there. He'd been boosting the radio out of the front seat. Turns out that there had been a number of thefts from cars in the neighborhood, and just maybe they got their guy that night. I don't know what happened next. Oftentimes you don't in those kinds of stories, but here's the link to the scripture today. As a security guard for a mall, in the parking lot of your girlfriend's apartment, you got about as much authority in holding and detaining a guy as he has in holding and detaining you. My authority really in any situation at that point was basically the authority I could muster by my own presence, and outside of that, it was a total bluff. By what authority do you do these things? Jesus is asked. Now we start getting into practicing the principles of all that theology that we've been discussing these past several weeks. But before we do that, let us pray. I lift mine eyes into the hills, whence cometh my help. My help is in the Maker of heaven and earth, the Father Almighty. Grant blessing on this time spent that the words spoken and the words heard might be one and the same. Spoken and heard, they'll be pleasing in your sight. Amen. Authority. Jesus had it. The priests, the scribes, the Pharisees wanted it. The people are the ones who gave it. Well, if not them, the emperor in Rome. Oh, not really that either, but we'll get to that in a minute. Authority was a big, big deal in the ancient world. Still is in many respects. How do you know what you know, and by what right do you have to share the things you claim as fact? Jesus did many miracles to, in part, establish that sense of authority. Example. John 11 tells us the story of the raising of Lazarus. Walk through that story real quick. Jesus and the disciples are walking along when a messenger comes to them. Lazarus, your friend, is ill. Come quickly. They don't. A messenger comes. Lazarus, your friend who you love, is dead. Now in the ensuing discussion, Jesus says, Lazarus is dead so that he can be raised from the dead for the glory of God. It's pretty plain. But even as plain as it is, the disciples and everyone else just don't get it. Jesus and the disciples journey to Bethany, to Lazarus' house. They greet his sisters who are in mourning. He asks them if they have faith. They both reply yes. He goes out to the tomb where Lazarus has already been buried for a few days. And there we have it, the shortest line of scripture. Jesus wept. For whom did Jesus weep? Come on now, serious question. Shout it loud. For whom did Jesus weep? Who? Us. Us. Us, metaphorically, through all the people that were right there, because all those people, he wept because they needed yet another miracle that they might believe that which they should already believe. He's in a house he's been to time and time and time again. His disciples have been there every step of the way, and they all need to see it once again so that they might believe for themselves that which they should already believe, or worse yet, in seeing it, some still would not believe. Authority. Jesus did this and other miracles because it created a sense of authority. But then it was a false sense of authority. Real authority is simply meant to be in following and understanding that Christ comes because God the Father sent. Found too in the ever presence of the Holy Spirit that wraps around us any time we need. Oh, do you believe because you have seen? Blessed are those who do not see, yet they believe. Anyone remember where that line came from? Doubting Thomas. Doubting Thomas. Thomas, who was told of the resurrected Christ, but he said he would not believe until he placed his own fingers into the marks of the nail and his hand into the hollow of his side. Not that any of the other disciples really believed that any better until they saw that same authority of the risen Christ. It's just that Thomas doubted they who had already doubted and had been convinced. So his doubt stands all the more. But are we really any better? Sometimes I wonder. Authority. Jesus had it. The priests, the scribes, the Pharisees, they all wanted it. And they felt it was the people who gave it. The religious elite in various offices and stations wanted to be the authority in all things. They worshiped the law. They knew it backwards and forwards and were the prime interpreters of it. And yet when it came to things outside the strict confines of the law, they looked to the masses to determine whether they should move left or whether they should move right. Now there's a couple of things to note in the exchange in the first part of the scripture reading. Jesus was no stranger to any of these people. He frequently taught in the temple and the synagogues and in the meeting places, out in the open around town. And the scribes and the priests and the Pharisees knew his face. And they knew what he taught already. They were always looking for opportunities to be able to bring him up on charges. And they always failed. They didn't need Judas to betray him. that last night in the garden. They knew who he was. He spent most of his time in their easy grasp. They needed Judas because they were afraid of the crowds, the elite, the leaders of their church. Were afraid of the crowds and the masses because they had no real authority on their own. Jesus asks them a question they cannot answer because they are afraid. They know the right answer to them, but they can't say it because they're afraid of the crowd and they don't have authority to stand over the crowd. In a simple question of authority, they fear giving the wrong answer as well. The religious elite wanted it, and the crowd gave it. Or Rome. But not really. It's one of those important things stated at the United Methodist ordination service. The bishop lays hands upon the ordinal and says, "Take thou authority to preach the word of God." There's only one answer. The call of God. It's not about pleasing the crowd. It's not about answering desires or preferences. It's not about serving anything other than God's will, the Father's will. And it's generally not the popular thing to do. But if you do it with authority given by God, it does not matter. The father told two sons to go out in the field, tend to the crops. One said no. Changed his mind. Went out and worked. The other said, "Sure, I'll go." Never went. Which one did the father's will? Well, in all honesty, neither of them did. The right answer was to say yes and to go right out and go do it. We're all parents. Perfect example. Clean your room. My children would spend more time trying to look busy than to actually be busy. Might get clean by next week. Who knows? But at least the first son eventually went out and got there. What is far worse is the son that said yes and then never goes. He never does. We've spent the past several weeks on the theology to get ready for these coming weeks, our transition towards Advent. It's when we focus on All Saints, the example of those who have gone on before. Stewardship, our ongoing care of the responsibilities of the church. And maybe most important of all, Christ the King Sunday. The one Sunday a year where we actually take time to focus on the book of the Revelation. On judgment. Only in the lectionary for this year, we actually have three Sundays here where we read judgment texts. Because hidden under this parable that Jesus tells is that judgment over the two sons. That judgment that then is placed upon the religious elite that should be following the way of Christ. The tax collectors and the prostitutes who actually listened to the word of John the Baptist would repent and change their ways. both were told what they were supposed to go and do. One eventually got there. The other continues to seek authority in themselves. These are the places where we have to examine ourselves to hold up that question we asked last week. Are you ready? But more than that, to see in our lives, in our practices, in our actions, whether we can truly see a reflection of that answer. We're not necessarily called to go out into a field. Well, yeah, we are. The field out beyond the walls of this sanctuary. We're not told to care for a crop. Oh, yes, we are. The crop is humankind, to care for widows and orphans, the sick, the downtrodden, to care for the stranger in our midst. The refugee, the alien. I'm not trying to be political. I'm just trying to quote you some scripture. To take care of your sister, your brother, all of them, any of them, red and yellow, black and white, green, blue, purple, plaid, whatever they come in. To visit the prisoner. To set the oppressed free. When was the last time any of us visited CCNO? Voluntarily. Just telling you what's there in Matthew 25 and Isaiah 58 and Leviticus 19. And if you can't answer yes, then the invitation for confession, repentance, and trying better to do tomorrow. That's what this table is all about. We come to a point of communion. Place where we seek to be reconciled with God. To remember that we are saved through grace and by grace alone. By the sacrifice this table represents. Grace that is edible and we take into ourselves, that has the ability to change us, to strengthen us. We are reminded that we are fully forgiven. Fully forgiven. But the point in repentance is to actually turn away. Turn away from the things that separate us from God and turn towards God. Good news. Your sins are forgiven. On the night that he was betrayed, we remember that Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins." As often as you eat of it, do so in remembrance of me. Likewise, when the meal was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, each of you, drink. This is the cup of the new covenant poured out in my blood for the forgiveness of sins, for yours and for many. As often as you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Almighty God, pour out your Spirit upon these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, broken and poured out for a sinful, hurting world. Even as we offer ourselves up, following in his example as a living sacrifice for a broken and sinful world. Make us one with each other, one with Christ, one with you, through the power of your Holy Spirit, and in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Mind you that Sacrament of Communion is an open sacrament in the United Methodist Church. All ye who sincerely and earnestly repent of your sins and seek reconciliation in the body of Christ, take this sacrament for your comfort. Do communion by intinction today. You'll be directed by the ushers to come down the center aisle to the front or to the back. We'll have four stations. Take the bread, dip it into the cup. Have them both together. In doing so, you make a public witness. Public witness that you are in the community of God on this World Communion Sunday. Will those who are serving communion come forward? Let us pray. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
And now as the ushers come forward, let's prepare our hearts and minds for this morning's offering. And please remember to fill out the response forms and put those in the offering plate as those are passed also. Let us pray. Most gracious God, you hold each person's life as more precious than we can imagine. When we turn aside from following your way, you urgently call us back to your way. Send your Spirit to give us a new heart to live as faithful people who show forgiveness to others. We dedicate our lives and our money to help share your good news with our neighbors. We pray through Christ your Son, who gave his life for the sake of the world. Amen.
I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear. Washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
For our final hymn, we'll sing verses 1 and verse 3.
Thank you.
the assurance you are created in the image of God, redeemed by the blood of His Son, Jesus Christ, guided and protected by His Holy Spirit, prepared to face the trials of tomorrow. Amen.